Sponsor, and I tell you, they have been such a tremendous partner of the chamber, of the school district, of our community. Our presenting sponsor today is Insperity, and representing Insperity is Corinne Price.
Thank you, Robert. You may be seated. I'm going to be up here for a really long time. Now, it's great to see all of you. You know, I know you guys see Insperity out in the community. Everybody noticed that we're adding another building on 484? Good. Yes, it is another building, four-story, and we're going to have a parking garage. And unfortunately, we're not doing like a major hiring thrust. We're actually bringing people back from our JFK office and bringing them back onto our campus. So, I mean, we're still hiring, but it's not like we're hiring 200 new people. So, just so that you know, you're in the know, you know why we're building that building. But just in case you don't know exactly what Insperity does, let me just fill you in. We are, best way to describe us, an HR company for primarily small to medium-sized businesses. So what we do is we provide business solutions to business owners and to nonprofit organizations to take care of all their HR needs, payroll, 401k, time and attendance, those types of things, workers' comp. And we're nationwide. We're also a public traded company. We have lots of solutions. But besides what we do to make business owners' lives just wonderful, is we also give back into our communities. Our mission statement is that we help businesses succeed so communities prosper. And we make sure that every place that we have an office, which we have about 55 offices in about 22 cities around the US, that changes like on a daily basis, but that we make sure we're always giving back to our communities. And whether that's being involved in the chambers or with nonprofit organizations around the US, we do all of those things. So I'd like to acknowledge a couple of our Insperitans that we have in the room. There's one, Angela Conrad, and where's Robert Scarfo? He's over here. Not quite as enthusiastic. Come on, Robert. To be a part of the Chamber of Commerce here and to help promote business and to make our community a better place. So thank you for this opportunity. We're also very excited to be the title sponsor for this particular luncheon. We have the greatest admiration for Kevin Brady and all that he's doing to help businesses, especially small businesses, and to give them some relief from all the federal regulations that have weighed them down and made their jobs not so much fun as they used to be. So we're hoping to change that, and we thank you for all that you're doing. So thanks again.
Thanks, Corinne, and all the folks at Insperity for all you do for our community. We really appreciate that. It's now my privilege to introduce one of my fellow chamber board members to introduce our speaker today, Ms. Carol Brady.
Thank you, Robert. You may be seated. I'm never going to get another chance to say that to him, so I thought, what the heck, go for it. It's really an honor, and it's probably only going to happen this one time that I get to actually introduce Congressman Brady. There are two real benefits to being Kevin's sister. The first one is I get all the free campaign t-shirts I want as long as I log all my volunteer hours for block walking, and he does ask me to log those. The other nice thing is I actually don't have to call him Congressman Brady while we're in private. I'm able to call him either Mr. Chairman or Your Honor, and that's just a regular guy, so just so you know that. Remember, I work, live, and play here, so, okay, it goes both ways, just saying. So, exactly. I'll give you the speech that was written for Kevin, and it leaves a few things out, so I'll add a couple of things, but for the most part, what you need to know about Congressman Kevin Brady, he's only the third Texan in 226 years to lead the powerful House Ways and Means Committee. The first and oldest committee in Congress, it shapes the future of our nation through its power over taxes, trade, healthcare, welfare, Social Security, and Medicare. Providing what conservative Texas leadership can achieve, in the first 60 days as chairman, he cut taxes by over $600 billion. That's B, billion. Helped lift the oil export ban, stopped President Obama's $10 a barrel oil tax, and forced into law the first ban against the IRS targeting of Americans based on their political beliefs. He also helped write the only bill repealing Obamacare and defunding Planned Parenthood to ever reach the president's desk. Yes, absolutely. He hasn't stopped working for our conservative causes. In the last 60 days, he led the House Republican Task Force to reform welfare and repeal and replace Obamacare. And just last month, he unveiled the House Republican Tax Reform Blueprint that Stephen Moore of the Heritage Foundation described as a thing of economic beauty. And Forbes magazine predicts will vault America back into the lead of a world economic competitiveness. I got the honor over the 4th of July weekend to actually hear this. Most people, when they're together for 4th of July in the pool, they're talking about their kids. I got a blueprint of the tax reform. And I have to tell you, while I don't normally get excited over tax reform, it was pretty exciting. And I was really, really impressed and excited that he was coming here to roll this out. While I understand he's a very, very important man in Washington, Kevin truly is a wonderful man. He cares about this country, he cares about the community, and I'm very proud to call him my brother. He's here today to tell us more about his revolutionary plan to bust up the IRS and make the tax code so simple, absolutely, so simple and fair that it can fit on a postcard. So Kevin, welcome to our chamber. Congressman Kevin.
I cannot tell you how nervous I've been about having Carol introduce me. She is remarkable, but she knows way too much. And so, just for the record, she has three brothers. I'm the nice brother, just so you know. That's my story, so I'm going to stick with that. Carol has always done remarkable work. You know how much she cares for our homeless. The faith-based program, Family Promise, does amazing things. She's always done these things. She's always gone beyond school, gone beyond college, gone beyond being a mom to help give back the community. And I know Family Promise because the way she runs it and a remarkable board of directors does amazing things with these families. You should see the hours she puts on. And I may be talking tax reform the 4th of July. She's answering the phone to help get some family in a really tough situation into housing, you know, into job, help for the kids, working with the schools, really does a remarkable job. So Carol, thank you for all you do. I also want to thank the chamber, Robert. This is a remarkable chamber. It's always had a reputation for being the voice of business in the area, very effective from infrastructure to education to everywhere in between. You have a reputation for a great board of directors and that reputation continues. Thank you for your leadership in this chamber. And Jenna, please join me. And then Jenna, congratulations on taking over the leadership of this chamber. Again, a tremendous reputation. You've got such great background. And you may not know it, but Jenna's not just leading here in our community in this area, Bumble and Kingwood and Lake Hughes and Tascosa, but she's on leadership of the Texas Chamber of Commerce executives, and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce has tapped her to help lead our region in continuing education for chamber professionals. So, Jenna, your reach is far beyond our community. We're really blessed, too. We have great businesses and great elected officials in this area, and I'm really thrilled when I get a chance to work with Brandon Crichton and Dan Huberty on Texas issues. Lord knows Washington creates enough problems for them. It's good to work with you to do that. And I know we always rely upon Judge Emmett and our commissioners, Cable and Morgan, on infrastructure and other issues, but boy, when it floods in our area, no one works harder to help families and help them recover than our county judge and county commissioner. So thank you for all you do as well. And Dr. Sconzo, you've been an iconic leader for education and beyond that, by the way, in this community for so long. You've touched so many lives. Thank you for your leadership. Disparity, thanks for hosting today, but more importantly, we've had a chance to work at the national level, passing legislation to ensure that companies like yours could reach out and provide help to a lot of our small businesses who are just buried under regulation. And when they're just struggling, they just want to do their job, you know what I mean, and grow their business and meet their customers' demands, and government just keeps piling on them. And you guys do a terrific job, so thank you for your leadership as well. Final point, most important one. Boy, thank you for sending Judge Ted Pope to represent you in Congress, or many of you in Congress. Ted Pope is a remarkable man of character. He has emerged as a national leader on so many issues, including human trafficking, on terrorism, on border security and all that. I know he is, he's recovering well, in good spirits. We checked in with his team this morning as well, and doing well. So keep him in your prayers. Let's get him. We need him back there as he recovers, and I know we're all praying. So are any of you ready to change this tax code? At the beginning of last year, House Republicans, not knowing exactly how the presidential campaign would roll out, no one did, but we decided the contests aren't just, the elections just aren't contests of personalities, they're contests of ideas. And so we picked the six toughest problems facing America and began to work to lay out solutions to do that, to change the direction of the country by tackling big issues. And we decided we would run on those solutions. And if we are sent back in the majority next year, we are going to move those solutions forward. And there are six big issues, and starting, as you'd imagine, with national security and terrorism, restoring the Constitution, lifting red tape from our businesses, our local businesses, so they can grow. But three of those top ideas, I had a chance to lead them. One was in replacing the Affordable Care Act and saving Medicare, exactly how we would do that. Reforming welfare to get people, there are more Americans today on welfare than are working full time. The number in poverty, imagine every man, woman, and child in 24 states, that's how many Americans are in poverty. They've been there a long time. They're not getting out unless we think differently. So we laid out how we get people back into that first, sort of reaching that for that first rung on the economic ladder. And I'd invite you, we have a website called Better GOP. We decided to name our effort the Better Way for America. I invite you to come to that, take a look at those solutions and ideas, because they came from you. We looked at what works in our communities, from the homeless to Pam for the work you do, those in the need in our community, and applied it at the national level. So I invite you to do that. But the sort of the crown jewel of the Better Way agenda was fixing this broken tax code. We don't have, and here's my thought. We don't have to settle for the economy we have today. It's a bit of a second-rate economy, unfortunately. Millions of qualified Americans can't find full-time work. For most Americans, they really haven't seen a raise in their paychecks in almost a decade. We were doing better in Texas than a lot of areas, but for a lot of Americans, prices keep going up and nothing changes in their family budget. And you can't go online or pick up a newspaper once every 2 weeks, Danny, that we're not seeing some American company, some Texas company, pulling up roots and moving overseas. And it is continues to be in Niagara Falls, leaving not just our headquarters, but our manufacturing, our research, our technology, sometimes our best people, forced out of America. And the biggest problem is our tax code. It's costly, it's complex, mainly it's unfair. And it's been 30 years since President Reagan and Houston's own James Baker reformed and fixed this tax code. And I don't know about you, but I think it's long overdue for a complete reboot of how America taxes, how our government taxes you and me. So the two goals I set for our House Republicans, first is, rather than have a tax code that's designed simply to wring money from you and collect taxes, I said we need a tax code built for growth. Built for the growth of paychecks, built for the growth of local jobs, built for the growth of the U.S. economy. Goal number one. Second goal is that I want to leapfrog America from dead last among our global competitors, which is where we're at, unfortunately. Leapfrog us, get us back in to the lead pack of tax codes on the planet and keep us there so that we are the best place in the world for investment in research and new jobs and headquarters. And so let me lay out those how we go about that. And let me just tell you up front, we're proposing this to you, not imposing it to you. My belief is this isn't our tax code, America. This is yours. For the first time in it, you ought to have a say, a real say, in how you're taxed. So we're offering this to you. And we're dead serious. This is the first time since before President Reagan fixed the tax code, first time in 30 years, House Republicans have all agreed on a tax reform proposal. We laid it out a month ago. You didn't hear about it because we had the wisdom of unveiling this in a major press conference the morning after Britain voted to leave the European Union. As you would imagine, nobody saw that thing. Carol didn't even see that thing. And I was bugging her. So we're spending the rest of this year in town hall meetings across America. There are hundreds of them occurring just like this across America, asking you, do you want a fairer and simpler tax code? You know, do you want to have a say in the way you're taxed? And we're going to take, so we're on listening mode, and then we're going to take what we hear from you, make this proposal even better. We're writing this proposal as we speak through my tax team, and then in the first half of 2017, we're going to bring this to vote in the U.S. House, because the Constitution says this can only start in the Ways and Means Committee in the U.S. House. So we're serious about finally taking action on tax reform. Here's our proposal. It breaks into three major reforms. First, we go all in for growth on jobs and paychecks by recommending the lowest tax rates on history, on businesses in modern history. First big reform. Second is we propose a tax code for families and individuals so fair and simple, literally, it can fit on a postcard. And thirdly, we propose to bust up the IRS to make it work for us rather than against us. Let me tell you the three. So, with business and jobs, we propose, right now, America has the highest corporate rate really in the world, effectively. And we have high rates whether you're a corporation or a family-owned business, a small business or a partnership, we tax you like nobody's business. So we propose to lower those rates, to take less of the money our businesses earn on a simple principle. We want you to grow the local economy rather than send your money up there and grow Washington's economy. So we propose a tax rate for corporations, which can be one person or it can be ExxonMobil, of 20%. That's cutting that rate almost in half. For every other type of business, you might be a sole proprietorship, you might be a partnership, limited liability corporation, we propose an equal cut from 44.6, that's what it is today, down to 25%. Again, the lowest rates in more than 80 years, so our local businesses can survive tough times and grow in better times. We also know companies in America, businesses in America, just don't compete along 59 or along Main Street number. Many of our businesses compete around the world. Today, we do something almost no country does. We tax our local businesses here. We tax them when they compete abroad. And then when they succeed, when they compete and win and make earnings, we tax them to bring that money home to America to reinvest it in local jobs or buildings or research. We punish them to bring their money home from America. And as a result, guess where they keep most of their money? Overseas. That's insane. So we proposed for the first time, we stop doing it. We tax companies here in America. We don't overseas. And when Chevron Phillips down the road, or an ExxonMobil, or an Anadarko, or whoever, when they compete and win, we propose the tax rate to bring that money back to America be 0%. So we don't like lower the tax rate, we obliterate it, bring it back to America. We don't stop there. We are also one of the few countries that keeps taxing our made in America products when we sell them around the world. We know this, the impact in Texas. No state sells or ships more around the world than Texas. We're number one in America. We're really good at this. But our made in America products, they're at a disadvantage because of the tax code. Here at home, they're at a disadvantage when they're selling in China or Europe or Brazil. And so we propose, first time in history, let's stop taxing made in America products when we're selling them around the world. And let's tax imports in the U.S. So no longer will made in America products, made in Texas products, be at a price disadvantage here and abroad. Let's have competition based on price and quality and service, not a competition based on the tax codes. And when we do that, a couple really good things happen. One, made in America products now are competitive. We've eliminated in almost one fell swoop any incentive to move American companies overseas. And we've seen a lot of that over the years. There's a reason Burger King is headquartered in Canada. There's a reason almost all our beer companies are owned by foreign companies. Because our tax code gives a foreign company about a 30% advantage over our American company, even here in America. Here in America. We look around our area from our oil field energy services from Weatherford to Cooper to Transocean, Neighbors, Noble, on and on. Used to be Texas companies, Waste Connections. Now headquartered in Canada, Ireland, England, Bermuda, Switzerland, on and on. So we're making this proposal to stop taxing made in America products, which is a pretty big change from where it's been in the past, because my goal, our goal, isn't simply to stop American companies from leaving our country, we want to bring them back. Our goal is to bring those jobs and that manufacturing and that research and that next new medical breakthrough back to America. And so that's why we're pushing hard on some sort of game-changing approaches. We don't stop there either. We know this whole thing ought to be focused on creating Main Street jobs. Not government jobs, Main Street jobs. What we know from looking back 50 years, if you ask, just look. So what creates jobs, Main Street jobs? So I had our team look at government spending, consumer spending, just about every element you could imagine. There was one that tied to Main Street jobs. When it went up, jobs went up. When it went down, jobs went up. And it just follows it like it was married for 50 years. And that is business investment. When our businesses locally buy that new building, buy that new equipment, buy that new computer, the new technology, jobs grow like nobody's business. So we're proposing, again for the first time, that all businesses, large or small, be able to immediately write off from their taxes that year an unlimited amount of business investment. So the tax rate for all new business investment will be zero at Kroger, it'll be zero at Insperity, it'll be zero at your place, Nanny, going forward. That may be the most pro-growth part of this whole blueprint. We don't stop there either. Our businesses, like our families, are subject to that second tax, the alternative minimum tax. We propose to eliminate that. And then finally, the favorite part of the blueprint for me, because I've been working on it for so long, we propose to you for the first time since it was established in 1916 that we permanently end the death tax, that we permanently do away with the estate tax, because it is still, I think, the most un-American tax we have. Think about this. You worked your whole life to create a nest egg, build up a nest egg, create a family-owned business, maybe take over your family-owned farm. You work a whole lifetime. You pass away, and Uncle Sam swoops in and takes nearly half of everything you've earned above a certain amount. It's wrong. It's still the number one reason family-owned businesses and farms aren't passed down to the kids and grandkids. We propose to eliminate it. And so if you take all those pro-jobs provisions together, the Tax Foundation has analyzed this blueprint and estimates it will grow the American economy not 1%. It'll grow at more than 9%. Big growth in how we operate. They also predict the wages on average will go up about 8%. Higher than it is today. And they estimate that our goal, what we'd hope to do in this, will be achieved in the sense that they estimate that America will vault back into that leadership pack of pro-growth tax codes around the world. So we go all in for jobs. The second reform, all in for fairness and simplicity for families. Growth is good. Growth is good. Everywhere but in the size of the tax code. And man, has it been growing. Since President Reagan reformed it, it's tripled in size. 70,000 pages. Just think, in the last decade, there have been 4,000 changes in the tax law. One new tax law a day. Can anyone here name those? No one can keep up with this, especially our small businesses. And for years, you know, Americans have just begged Washington, you know, why can't we have a tax code so fair and simple and understandable? It could fit on a postcard. And for years, Washington just sort of dismissed it, poo-pooed it, won't work. Well, guess what? We did the work. That's exactly what we're proposing to you. The tax code that fair and that simple. Here's how we propose we do it. First, we flattened down the tax brackets. When President Reagan began his reforms, there were 15 different tax brackets. He cut it by more than half to 7. We propose to flatten it down to just 3, so we make it even simpler. We propose to lower those brackets at every level so families can keep more of what they earn. So the top rate today is really 44.6%. We propose the top rate be a third, 33%. Then a 25% rate, and then for most Americans we'll be at a 12% rate. So we simplify the brackets, we lower them. We also increased the standard deduction pretty dramatically. We nearly doubled it. That's so people can keep a little more of those first dollars for they and their families. That helps. And then we do something, I think, maybe the second most pro-growth part of this proposal to you. We cut the taxes on savings and investment to half. So whatever your normal tax rate will be for the interests, for interest, for dividends, for capital gains, we propose we cut that in half. And here's why. One, our tax code right now discourages savings. And we're not a country that saves, frankly. We need to do that for our retirement, for our business. And so we propose to cut those rates in half. But there's something else that happens, too, when you do that. It grows the economy. And you'll remember this from what Dr. Sconzo's teachers would have taught us in high school, that when you and I earn a dollar, there's only really 3 things we can do with it. We can spend it, we can save it, we can invest it. So think about that. So we can spend it. So you can buy a donut. Apparently that's what I do regularly. Not so good for me, good for the local company. So you can, and Danny, do not say a word. Rob, don't either. So. You can save it. So we can put it in a bank in Kingwood, Numble, Pascasita. That's good for you as a family. It's also good for the economy because that money comes right back out. Loaned to local businesses. Maybe loaned to that donut shop owner. So he or she can buy a second mixer, another glazer, maybe a deep fat fryer. Maybe even hire another worker for that pre-dawn shift. That's really good for the economy. Or we can invest it. Now you're thinking, how does he know so much about donut shops? So I know, like I know what you're doing here. Sorry. So, should have picked something else. I know this. Thirdly, you can invest it. So you might do it in the stock market, you might do it in mutual funds. Maybe, donut shop. I'm going there, so maybe you invested in that donut shop. And so they can add a second location or a third location. Maybe expand to lunches. That's really good for the economy. So the reason we're proposing we cut rates so low on savings investment, it's good for us as families, really good for the economy as well. And we're going all in for that economy. So we don't stop there. As you know, there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of special provisions in the tax code. So many, it's stunning. It is stunning how many there are. To simplify this, for the postcard, we really thought about what most families need and count on. And that's what we're recommending for the postcard. Besides those lower tax rates and even lower rates for savings, we propose to keep that's someone in support of tax reform. So, that was our best shot. Now I'm off message. We thought about, okay, what do families need? What do they rely upon? So what we're proposing to keep on the postcard is the home mortgage deduction. For most families, the home's the most valuable thing they own. And so we all make it easy to buy and to keep on. Secondly, we keep the charitable deduction. In fact, we're looking at ways to make it better. I want you to give more charitably here at home. Because we know when you give to the church, when you give to Northeast Ministries, to Family Promise, to all our local wonderful, amazing groups, we know not only does that money go to help people directly, but you hold them accountable. You know, those organizations, they either deliver for you or you don't give it to them the next year. So we propose to keep and maybe improve the charitable deductions. But look at what it costs to raise a family, incredibly expensive. So we propose to not just keep the child tax credit, but make it a little bigger to help you raise your kids. And then because college or getting a technical degree is expensive, sometimes wildly expensive, we propose on the postcard we keep that help with college or a technical school. We've got, as you know, we live in Montgomery County. Kath and I have two teenage boys. I continue to commute each week. But we got an eighth grader, soon to be senior in high school, at College Park High School. He's Will. He was just named president of FFA. Really a great program. You know, I don't know about your teenage boys. He's incredibly disorganized, incredibly unfocused. So when I heard he's president of FFA, I turned to my wife and said, congratulations, you're the new president. And you gotta line him out. So that's how it works in our house. So, and I think, you know, you always worry about your kids. And so, and I think he's gonna go into welding. I think he wants some custom fabrication, maybe own a small business of his own someday. So he's gonna do a technical school as well as probably, it's expensive. So let's make sure families have help in that expensive part of their life. And then other than one other provision to help people get from welfare to work, which we're going to redesign because it doesn't work the way it should right now. That's it. That's what we're proposing for the postcard. That fair and that simple. But the reason I start out with this is your tax code is that you need to decide. If you want a code that fair and that simple, we can put anything you want back on that postcard. We can put dozens of provisions. We can put hundreds of provisions. We can turn this back into a telephone book if you want. Just as long as we all know to do that, we have to send more money to Washington and hope we can beg to get some of it back. There's a trade-off here. So we can put back, you know, that credit you get for energy-efficient home windows in your home, we can put that back. The $7,000 credit you get when you buy a new Tesla, yes, there is one. We can put that back. We can put your gambling debts back on here. Not that that would impact anyone in this room at all. We can put all those back if you want. Again, we just have to know to do that, we're going to have to send more money to Washington. So I want you to think about this postcard, about what you think ought to be on there, and give me that feedback. Because we can only do this, we can only go this fair and this simple, if this is something the American public wants. My gut is you're ready for this. But you're going to have to let us know if that's the case. Then we finish with this. a fair and simpler tax code demands a fair and simpler tax collector. And so we propose to bust up the IRS. Yay. To take it out of, that's usually not an unpopular thing to say, but look, there's a reason for this. There is a reason for that. You're changing the tax code dramatically. You don't need the same agency. So we propose, rather than a big monstrosity, in some cases do target Americans. And this agency has the power to destroy your family, your business. So we propose to break it up into three smaller, much smaller focus units. One focused on business, staffed with tax experts in business, large or small, domestic, international, so we can get timely, accurate answers to our business questions. A second unit to do the same thing for families and individuals, because I don't know, how many of you tried to call the IRS to get a question answered? Okay, you didn't get through. And if you did, and if you talked to three people, you got three different answers to your question. That's not acceptable. That type of customer service isn't acceptable. I guarantee you it's not acceptable in your organization. So why should we stand by and take it? So focus on customer service, timely, accurate answers for you and me. Then the third unit that I'm thinking of, we'll bring this proposal back to you at the beginning of the year. I'm tired here at home running into people and small businesses who have a tax dispute with the IRS. Oftentimes minor ones. They'll spend years and years and thousands of dollars trying to resolve that. And even when they win, they've lost entirely. So what I'm recommending is that we create, independent of the IRS, independent of the Treasury, a small claims court. So that you and I can get our tax disputes worked out without having to hire lots of accountants, lots of tax attorneys, spend all this money. We ought to have an independent, objective body that helps us resolve these fairly. So that's the tax reform blueprint we're proposing to you. All in for growth for businesses, all in for fairness and simplicity on a postcard, then breaking up the IRS so they work for us rather than the other way around. So Carol, Robert, Jenna, with your permission, can I stop? And just take, like you were going to object, and then take some questions or thoughts or ideas, because, look, as a Chamber of Commerce, what I love about this chamber is you are the voice of business. I love the fact, I think most chambers squander their influence because they don't know what their priorities are, they're not communicating with their legislators, they don't know what they want us to work on. You're different. You know, your legislative team, public affairs team, put together a great list of priorities, came to Washington. I thought it was a great meeting that we had, and what I heard, it went well all around. You're really good at communicating and knowing what's important to you. And so when your legislative proposal says our top priority is tax reform, we're listening. So I want to listen, if you don't mind, right now. And can we just invite some questions or comments? That'd be okay? Good. Thoughts? Yes, sir. Robert, good to see you.
Carson, how are you going to deal with the onslaught of lobbyists, cottage industries that have drawn up the tax accounting? Is there just going to come?
Yeah. Did you hear the question? How are you going to deal with all the lobbyists and all those who oppose it? Well, we're making a bet here. There are some 60,000 plus lobbyists just in Washington. I've discovered most of them have something in the tax code they like. And so my day is filled. Oh yeah. So my day is filled with people telling me what we can't do to fix the tax code. We're making a bet that the American public can get behind this and blow through that. If we leave this just to Washington, Robert, it will not happen. We're sort of betting, we're laying a bet on we the people over we the lobbyists to do something like this. And so so much of it depends upon if we can gain public support. Yeah, honestly. And by the way, just so you know, I'm really a budget hawk. We designed all of this to break even within the budget. So we're serious about growing the economy. I'm also convinced with these deficits, spending cuts will get us halfway back to a balanced budget or more. But if we want to finish the job and start paying off the debt, we need a stronger economy. Do it. So this ties in sort of with another goal as well. Rob.
What kind of feedback are you getting from your Democrat?
Yeah, what kind of feedback from Democrats? Look, as expected, Leader Pelosi and others were immediately critical of this. But here's my thing. Watching how President Reagan achieved this in the 1980s, he was open to Democrats. Remember, it was a Democrat House and Democrat Senate. So he was open to their ideas at every step in the way. We're going to do the same. In fact, we've already invited our Democrat colleagues. Look, if you got ideas on how to grow the economy, simplify the code, make the IRS work for us rather than against us, we welcome it. And I think, at the end of the day, tax reform, sort of like health care, Medicare, Social Security, that the issue is so big, at the end of the day, it will need support from both parties. I don't expect that support to occur at every step in the way, you know what I mean? But at the end of the day, there are Democrat members of Ways and Means, certainly, who are tired of watching our American companies just flood overseas. They know we can't continue like this. We have a difference on how high taxes ought to be, and their first gut reaction is they would like higher taxes. Well, we want higher tax revenue because we're growing as a country. So, we're going to look for some common ground, Rob, on all this. But we are, regardless of how the election turns out, we're going to move forward with this. Yes?
I would love a working full commissions and bonuses be taxed out.
Say that again.
At what level were commissions and bonuses be taxed out?
Those, if they're normal income, they'll be at the 12, 25, and 33% level. If you're putting capital at risk, then it will be taxed the savings and investment level. So we want to make sure we're doing that. Because again, when you reinvest back in the community, in the economy, we want more of that. So can I ask, yes, Robert?
Do your rates include Social Security and Medicare tax?
You know, right now they are separate. We're taking a look at Social Security tax especially. The problem, I hate taxing Social Security. Problem is that program's financially shaky long term. So we're taking a look at all of that. Yes?
It all sounds really good. Almost too good to be true. I'm going to go with you for now.
Yeah.
What's the process? How long would it take to do a transition like this?
How long would it take to? It depends. You want the race to go into effect immediately because you want, look, we're going 1%. We've got to jumpstart this economy. So you want that to happen. The transition on how certain provisions affect businesses, you can lengthen. And here's the point I want to make, because you hit a really strong point. So how do you do this? Why does this work? Well, we're proposing to you some pretty big trade-offs. So we're proposing on business, for example, that we don't deduct interest deductibility. Because there are a dozen different ways for businesses to finance themselves. We as a government prefer one of them. And our point is, look, how you finance your business is your business, not ours. So they should all be treated the same. Because we're doing immediate expensing, so when you buy a room full of tables, you can write off immediately. If you can also write off the loan you got for it, at that point we're paying you to buy tables, so we can't do that. And by making some of those trade-offs, we can dramatically lower the rate for all businesses. The trade-off on families and individuals. We adopted our two girls. They're the biggest blessing in our lives. So we've used twice parts of the adoption tax credit. So the question is, can we eliminate a lot of those provisions that A, you never use in your lifetime or rarely use, in return for lower rates for a lifetime? So you can decide what to do with your earnings rather than us telling you if you do A, B, and C, you get rewarded. If you do D, E, and F, you get punished. Our thinking is, on a postcard, it really returns the power to you on how you use your earnings. So there's a reason I'm learning why tax reform doesn't happen but once a generation. This is difficult. You have to give a lot of thought to the trade-offs. That's where I want you thinking. Does that make sense? I mean, this is how you do it if you're going to do it without blowing a hole in the budget. Yes, sir.
Can you talk about the I don't want to sound like a pessimist, but the Democrats don't want to seem to work with the Republicans, even though they know that, hey, that sounds a good idea. It seems like there's so much divide. How do you plan to get this to go forward? Even if it did, how would the president even sign it?
Well, there'll be a new president by the time we start to move this. You know, a lot, again, to back to Robert's original point, a lot depends upon how strong public support is for making a change like this. If it's tepid and lukewarm and this really doesn't make a change, this isn't happening.
It needs to be a game plan. We've got a new president coming in. He's going to work with Trump to try to get this plan to work. You know, hearing Hillary's going to be president on all the polls, and it's scary to talk about it.
There's a big difference between two on taxes, you would imagine. I know Mr. Trump has echoed a lot of these provisions. He said, I want to do tax reform in the first 100 days. We're going to be ready for that. If it's Secretary Clinton, you know, it's a bigger challenge. You know, we don't know what the House or Senate is going to be. But here's the thing. Everyone's been waiting for all the stars to align, and maybe someday this would happen. But most people have just given up hope, I think. So the House has committed to putting this ball on the field and moving it down. And we'll see if the Senate, we'll see if the White House, we'll see who believes it's time for a change. And so we're going to do everything in our constitutional power to move this forward. And we've got, when you've got people like Ted Poe, for example, you know, who are just so articulate and able, frankly, to reach cross aisle on other issues. You know, we're going to rely on both the changes we're proposing that are pretty powerful and the public weighing on it. So it's not easy. But we can do this, just so you know. We can do this, and we're committed to it. Yes, ma'am.
With representation like yourself and Representative Poe, what can we do as a community to help you guys carry the ball?
Yeah, great question. First, look, pass a resolution at the Chamber Board saying you don't have to endorse every inch of this thing. You know, endorse the concepts and where we're trying to go and why. Incredibly helpful. Encourage others to do the same. Inform small businesses in the community and leaders like yourself about this. Encourage them to go they can go to Better GOP or to the House Ways and Means Committee. We have all the information there. Give us that feedback. Help spread the word. All of that is incredibly helpful. Because right now, as you know, the press is all focused on Mr. Trump and Secretary Clinton. I mean, that's all you're seeing. So we're going to have to fight pretty hard to get the word out about this. So that would be, do you have any other ideas?
I mean, I'm sure you guys are going to have a social media campaign, but that's a great way to get millennials involved. Hashtag, I mean, you've got a great team at your disposal, and then you've got a definitely supportive community here with the Lakers and Chamber.
Yeah, thank you. Well, as you know, people my age, others in this room, you know, we could probably muddle through the rest of our life with this horrible tax code. But why do our younger, why do our kids and grandkids, why do our new entrepreneurs, why do you have so for this? Our thinking is you don't. So let's do the hard work now to get this done. Yes, sir.
Kevin, speaking of us, was there consideration given to a not taxing Social Security?
Yeah.
As your AGI?
Or? Yeah, we are looking at that. I'm with you on that. It's tough to do to make Social Security solvent, but we are looking at that. We are looking at simplifying how we save. Right now, there are a lot of different savings tax provisions. They're so complicated. We were looking at saving for college and how we do it for our boys. There are 15 different education savings provisions. The cheat sheet for dummies is 90 pages long. 90 pages. So we can do better than that. So we're looking. In fact, we're on a conference call, Ways and Means Republicans, this afternoon on that very issue. How do we simplify, for example, education, healthcare, retirement accounts, make them bigger, more flexible, give you more control, simpler to do. So, yeah, we're taking a look at all of that. And so, look, I need to finish because you guys have other agenda items here, but can I just ask you, are we on the right for lowering taxes on businesses, becoming more competitive for our businesses? Are we on the right track generally? is having the code that fair and simple that the estimate is 95 to 98% of Americans would be able to file on a postcard type filing. Are we headed the right direction there on this? I know you want more time to study. Everyone good with busting up the IRS? I mean, if I find a person who doesn't clap for that, I'll tell you about it. But as of so far. So look, here's how you can help me. Clearly, we're listening. We want to make this better at every step in the way. Better at every step. So as you look at it and think about it and talk about it for your family and your small business, give me your feedback. And if you come to this Google Comms from Brady, Kevin Brady, there's a Bob Brady, Pennsylvania, different voting record. So Kevin Brady, right on the front, we've got something called feedback. Just click it. So give me your thoughts. We like this, we don't like this. How would this work? Ask your questions. We'll get back to you. But that feedback form, it's at the bottom of your postcard as well. Let me know what you're thinking because, you know, I'm really blessed to be able to lead the Ways and Means Committee. It is, you can have a huge impact on the way our country goes, but more importantly, on how our lives go, how our businesses go. So it is an honor to represent you in this region. Help me get this done. I think it's time for a change. Yep. So thank you.
Congressman Brady, before you leave the stage, we have a little small token of our appreciation. So thank you for taking time out of your day and come in and share it with us. We appreciate you.
Thank you.
All right, a couple things, some announcements and so forth. I'd like to invite Corey Turner to come up. We've got a big event coming up on Saturday right here in the Lake Houston area.
Thanks, Robert. I'm going to get us out of here really quickly. This is our last public announcement before the Lake Houston 10K, 5K. So we're almost at the finish line. See what I did there? If you have not registered, it's not too late. You can register the day of. Don't worry about rain. We have the rain under control. Jesus is on the main line. I've already told him what I want. So my Baptist people, y'all get that later. But Lake Houston 10K5K.com. Log on, get some more information. We look forward to seeing you out there. Thanks to Memorial Hermann and Texas Emergency Care for being our presenting sponsors.
Herman, thank you for all your efforts. Thank you. Next we have Terry Vaughn, who chairs our Public Affairs Committee, to make a couple announcements real quick.
Thank you, Robert. Well, I was gonna get up here and I had this whole speech, but Congressman Brady really set me up talking about how good we came with our priorities and our visit there, talking about our issues. So that's what I was going to talk to you about. So thank you so much there. You made my life a lot easier. We're really seeking the business community's feedback to help us formulate our priorities for the state legislature for fiscal 17. So on Tuesday, we sent a survey out to our members asking for feedback on state issues that affect your business. We encourage you to participate in this survey, fill it out. If you don't get the survey, or if you're here as a guest, please reach out to Jenna or myself or any other member of the chamber staff and let us know what your issues are so we can continue fighting at the state level. So thank you.
Thank you, Terry. Appreciate that. I know the folks at the school district, we partnered with the chamber. We have a legislative committee also, and we'll be bringing our agenda to the chamber. It's been a good joint effort, good partnership. We sent a group to D.C. with the chamber, and we'll be sending a group to Austin as well. So thank y'all very much for that. I want to also thank again our gold sponsor, Kroger, our bronze sponsor, FFG Strategic Consulting, LLC Engineering Solutions. And once again, thank you, Insperity, for all you do and for being our title sponsor here. And Congressman Brady, thank you once again. I know you have a busy schedule, and we couldn't be honored more to have you here and share your thoughts and ideas with us. And I think I can speak for the rest of the room. We'll do anything we can to help. With that said, we're dismissed. Thank you so much.